who has spent long years in the ICR, Dr. Subhachandran, professor from National Institute of Advanced Study, Bangalore, all the distinguishing delegates, especially very knowledgeable persons from different walks of life, ladies and gentlemen. Sri Karthikeyan narrated his experience, especially what he has seen over the years, what agriculture has faced over all these years, and whether it has changed very much from what it was in the past. And he gave beautiful examples at certain different time intervals. He raised many significant issues, which I am certain I'll address. At the same time, Dr. Dev Kumar, he spoke about the success that agriculture has witnessed over these years and what needs to be done, especially the areas which he narrated. Of course, Dr. Subhachandran, being very much a professor and a scientist dedicated to his profession, gave his experience through his lens as a farmer. He was a part-time farmer. So, all these experience, naturally all these narrations must have confused the audience to a significant extent, giving a feeling that today agriculture is in doldrums. I must tell with confidence that Indian agriculture has seen new heights in spite of the problem that has been mentioned just now. Last year, we witnessed a bumper production of 275 million tons of food grains, 300 million tons of horticulture produce, that is fruits and vegetables. This is unprecedented in the history of India. 2 years back, you remember that the price of tur dal touched 180 rupees to 200 rupees a kg. Those were the years where India witnessed one of the most severe droughts, 15-16 and 14-15. Came 16-17, the government was really worried whether we should continue to import pulses and feed our population. Because we are a vegetarian country, the only source of protein is dal or pulse, and that if people cannot afford, then where will we will go? This challenge was thrown at us. 16-17 and 17-18, came 16-17, I am taking you back in time. When this challenge was thrown, we took this challenge. India witnessed a second green revolution, I must say. Why I said second green revolution? In one single year, 16-17, India produced 6 million tons of extra pulses. Our pulse production, which was hovering around 17 million tons, saw a jump of 6 million tons more, and we touched a figure of 23.8 million tons of pulse production in one single year. When that was discussed in the public domain, people said, thank to rain gods, we got this. I said, come next year, it's going to happen. And came next year, 17-18, we also touched the same figure. Rain gods were also bountiful. They were showering their mercies even in the past. We never witnessed this sort of pulse production in this country. And this happened to a number of factors, rain being one of them. The government put in place the very quality seeds which have been mentioned. We created 150 seed hubs in this country to give quality seeds to our farmers. We put a mechanism of MSP where higher prices were announced by the government for pulses. We also put a mechanism to create a buffer stock for pulses, and this was also first of its kind because buffer stock for pulses was there only for rice and wheat, and Food Corporation continues to buy that. So therefore you don't see any problem in those two cereal crops. But in pulses, first time 2 million tons of buffer stock was created, for which, and this is also first of its kind in the history of India, therefore, and massive procurement was done by the government by announcing MSP, which raised the confidence, and we had a bumper pulse production, for which prices started plummeting. And this plummeting of stock, combined with the anxiety of the yesteryears that we have a shortage, also resulted in a little bit of a different type of problem, the problem of plenty. This year you have also seen the monsoon forecast. We are going to enter into the third year in which monsoon is going to be very good. The government is fully geared to face this challenge, and we are going to witness bumper production. The individual experience of farmers may vary, but if you see the experience at the macro level, it's entirely different. I must give you statistics, and why I do give statistics, because I do not want to speak from personal experience. I want to give you statistics that India sold, all the Indian companies joined together, sold 6 lakh tractors last year. You know, I don't buy a tractor to travel from one place to another, to my neighbor's place, like you buy cars. Who bought these tractors? People like you and me never bought tractors. We all buy cars or scooters. So who bought these tractors, and why the farmers are buying these tractors? This itself speaks volumes about how Indian agriculture is progressing. Take the balance sheets. You all speak about bank NPA and things like that every day. You are confronted with lots of figures. Take the balance sheet of the chemical companies who sell pesticides, fertilizers, and go on. See their balance sheet. It is growing. Who buys this? Industrialists buy this? You buy this? No. It's the farmer who buys it. If farmer is not partaking in the growth of this sector, how do you say that he is not doing well? This is the first question I want to throw at the audience, and let us speak from facts. Having said that, I want to also let you know that some of the problems which were just mentioned by the speakers, I welcome them, because that's the way, if you pose questions, we can have solutions. I can tell with confidence, today it is difficult to get human labor for farming. But due to the efforts and the creation of a new business space, there has been a phenomenal growth in the custom hiring centers. And a custom hiring center is one where agriculture machinery is available, both small and big ones, and people are hiring them for using it. And this has spread across the length and breadth of the country. Part of the 6 lakh tractors sold in this country also has gone to these custom hiring centers, I must say. It's not that everyone buys one. But the fact remains, there has been a phenomenal growth in the business space in the rural sector. The new challenges faced by agriculture is also throwing up new business opportunities. And that is what we must take advantage of. So therefore, mechanization has grown phenomenally. And at the same time, our dear friend Dr. Subhachandran mentioned that there has been problems in accessing several of these. He spoke about the fallow lands, the lack of access to water. This government very clearly launched a very big scheme called Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana. And what is this? A survey was made. It found that 99 major irrigation projects are languishing for the last several years, because sufficient resources were not made available to them. Lo and behold, the government put the resources, and now we are going to see that these projects are going to be completed very quickly, and the potential irrigated area going to be added is going to be phenomenal. Coupled with this is the launch of what is called the micro irrigation. This country has seen one of the biggest micro irrigation revolution. Prior to our Honorable Prime Minister going to Israel, I did go to Israel, and along with a couple of other secretaries. Israel was very proud of the fact that, please take, we are pioneers in micro irrigation, and India should continue to adopt it. you hardly know anything about micro irrigation. Yes, it is true. The type of technology used by Israel is different. The average rainfall in Israel does not exceed more than 500 millimeter. In India, the dry areas in India, which is considered dry, let's say parts of Rajasthan, parts of Karnataka, parts of Maharashtra, parts of Madhya Pradesh, the average rainfall is around 700 or 800 millimeter. You can't compare yourself with a country which receives 350, 400 mm of rainfall. The technology required for such handling such things is not necessarily what we need. We have got sufficient water. If 800 millimeter of waterfall is falling on our ground, we are sufficiently equipped to trap that water and make use of it for a second crop, apart from the first crop which we grow. And therefore, the soil conservation, the watershed approach, coupled with micro irrigation, is going to be the solution. God has been very kind to this country, and we must realize that. So long you do not realize that, then you are doomed. And this realization should come for everyone. When I say this, thanks to the drought of 2 years, every state government was sensitized that they need to do something for water. Came Jaliyukt Shivir in Maharashtra, came this mission Bhagirathi and Kakatiya in Telangana, came so many efforts that large number of water harvesting structures were constructed during this period. And when we received bountiful rainfall, except the southern peninsula of Tamil Nadu and the state I come from, Karnataka, almost everyone received bountiful rainfall and the reservoirs and the water harvesting structures were full. Therefore, you must have realized that a king was considered very great because of the public works he carried out. And what those days, in the ancient days of yore, the kings did was to construct huge tanks. And we all know, everyone points to a tank, it was built during this man's time, that man's time. That was nothing but water conservation. We need to do that. We neglected it over a period of time. We need to do it now. Once we do that, we are better prepared for growing climate smart crops. Our ancient food habits have been forgotten. Parts of this country grew millets and they ate it. They were healthy. Take Karnataka, it was known for growing finger millets called ragi. Jowar Bajra, of course, was there, but I am giving the ragi because it is a food which is highest in calcium. We gave them wheat and rice, the byproducts of Green Revolution, and they have forgotten it. Even Malayalis who used to grow rice, who used to eat rice, are only eating wheat nowadays. Malayalis who used to use coconut oil in the food, they are eating refined oil. And coconut oil is very good. Now, latest research says the all freshly ground oil are the best. They are good in oxidants. What is the antioxidants? You should not eat refined oil because they use a chemical process. And this is very healthy. So, by that logic, coconut oil is a good edible oil. Please go and check the Wikipedia. It has got lauric acid. And lauric acid is not available in any other food grain of this world. The freshly ground groundnut oil, mustard oil, are very good food. But we have an abuse of the entire process of development, which has resulted in the poverty of agriculture. So therefore, I think we were very deeply rooted in doing things. But today we live in a market-based economy. The problems expressed by Dr. Subhachandran is very correct. During his father's time, selling a coconut must be considered taboo because you are sharing the coconut with his friends in the village. Nobody can think of selling a coconut because those days a person like him owning 500,000 nuts must be a very big person. So he cannot ever think of selling. He must be distributing it among the villagers. So, to tell him to grow for the market is just not possible. Secondly, all the pains and agonies of Dr. Subha goes to prove that agriculture is a serious profession. It is not a part-time profession. You have to give your entire energy to this field. Just like you need to give your entire energy in the lab to find some scientific research, you have to give your entire energy to agriculture to solve this problem. I can say that, just to give one example, the same Tamil Nadu today has pioneered banana cultivation. They grow banana where the production is 70 tons per acre with drip irrigation, the G9 variety. They are growing it. They are extracting banana fiber from the stem of the banana and growing and selling shirts, saris and dhotis. With a blend of 70% banana fiber, 30% cotton, there is a house which exports abroad. The problem is today, we know lots of people are living agriculture. But internally, many people who are highly educated, they are very happy that people are living agriculture. Because they are occupying that space very fast. I know people from Silicon Valley. I know people from IT Valley, Bangalore. They are buying lands and they are entering this space. They are coming with new startups. And tomorrow, this same very land will be populated by them 10 years from now. And the farmers will be further, their condition may be impoverished. I won't be surprised. This is also the change which is happening. And I must tell you that this change also you must see. But I do agree with my friends that there is some problem with the farmers. The farmers are today facing this problem because they are one versus the many. So they need to unite together. And how does this happen? In the same very city of Bangalore, I must give the example. Hopcoms, which is a horticulture produce marketing society, has so many outlets. And there, every farmer has got access to market because that society which is managing the final produce is having so many outlets that they sell it and the farmer gets the right price. Why that cannot be organized in other parts of the country? The same thing is true. I'll give the example of a Campco. A Campco is a multi-state cooperative society between members of Karnataka and Kerala it is basically an arachnut and cocoa-based society. The once upon a time you must have seen that they sell chocolates also and it became very famous. So the same very farmer are doing extremely well in certain parts of the country and same very farmers are not doing well. So it's a mixed bag. I won't generalize and say that they are at one end or they are at the other. Success stories are there, unsuccessful stories are there. This happens in every field. In the field of education, people fail, people pass, the government therefore has changed the policy that no one will fail. So therefore, this has to be seen in this context. I can give you the example of a successful farmer producer organization. This has much flourished in the Maharashtra state. Sayadri Farmer Producer Organization. You please see in the Google today. 10,000 farmers have come together to group themselves and they are taking up post-harvest marketing linkages. Today they are exporting. Today they have outlets in Mumbai, Nasik, Pune. They are able to sell their produce. They are selling palak with a QR code. You go with your smartphone and check, you run it over, you will find the face of the farmer, the name of the farmer, what has he done, whether he's used organic, whether he's used fertilizer or not, everything is there. So there are people also like that. If you go, I left my story with Israel, but I must tell, miles together you find today drip irrigation being promoted. When I was in a discussion with the Israeli government, two companies sprang up there because they were also invited. One was a company, I must name them because it's not to be quoted, but one was a company, it was an Israeli company called Netafarm. Netafarm said, we do more business in India than many countries put together. And it was an Israeli company who made this mention. The Israelis were stunned. Then we had another company, which has bought a kibbutz there. It's again an Indian company. I think it is Jain Irrigation. So they also said, we add so many hectares every year under micro-irrigation. So the question is, many things are happening in India. It may not be replicable in all the states of the, and therefore we have mixed experience and we speak through the lens of our own eyes. But things are very sharply changing. I also do not want to claim that everywhere this is happening like it. East and Northeast has remained where they are. They are not adopting really the best of technology and best of things. But one thing has emerged very clearly, that we have had the strength of production, we have had the strength of technology, we are having everything. But yes, access to market is the most important limiting factor today facing the farmer. And therefore, if we have to empower the farmers, we have decided the farmer producer organization should be created on a massive scale. It is with this idea that the government in the recent budget said that any income arising out of a farmer producer organization is exempt from income tax. Because if a farmer produce individually is exempt from income tax, why not the output of a farmer producer company? Because once the company comes together, once these people come together, and when I say farmer producer company, it's not a corporate company. It's a company where the shareholder is the farmer only. The land owning farmer becomes the shareholder. He appoints the manager. And the manager is free to do marketing, to do accounting, to hire HR, whatever they are. But the farmers are the owners. If they can really group themselves, and we have changed our guidelines that any scheme, the beneficiary is not necessarily an individual, it will be a FPO also. So that the benefits of the scheme can really percolate through into the farmers, into these FPOs. And this is a big change which is happening, and this is going to see a rapid scaling up of the interest of these farmers fructifying. You know, today, I can give galores. So many e-platforms have come. Of course, government has launched the e-national agriculture market, which is a very unique intervention, where on an electronic platform, people can trade. But let us forget what government is doing. Government need not do everything. Take the example of Big Basket. Some of you may be accessing your fruits and vegetables through that. Where was it 2 years back? It was not there. Now several e-platforms have come up where you can access directly the produce of your choice. And there the middlemen are not many, because they source this from directly from the farmers to get a better price bargain. And this is the space which is, again, there is spawning of these type of e-markets in India. Because India is also passing through a very rapidly changing technological world. And that also is providing the ecosystem for these things to happen. Few years back, we did not know how to store apples. We thought apple could be stored in ordinary cold storages like potato was stored. Came the concept of CA storage or MA storage. That has changed. Now apple can be stored for longer duration, and therefore you see even the Himachal Pradesh apple or the Kashmir apple being made available during the off season. This was not a reality 10 years back, but now it is a reality. So it's a question of how things have changed. Even in the Northeast, I can tell with confidence that we grow kiwis which are as good as what is coming from New Zealand. And you will not be, maybe next time you go to some post market, you will find the kiwis of Arunachal Pradesh there. The farmers there are also equally, enlightened to do this. So, lots of things are happening. But at the same time, we must ensure that the interest of farmer is protected. Last year, our government also took very solid decisions in terms of protecting even the Indian market. We have altered the tariff structure because someone may say why India is changing its tariff structure only to protect the farmers. I must say, though WTO has given us the license to impose a tariff for what we import from abroad, we had never utilized the full potential of that. And very recently, that's in the last 6 to 8 months, we have taken conscious decision to raise our tariffs in compliance with the WTO norms. And we have imposed these on pulses. Today, India is self-sufficient in all the cereals, in all the pulses, except that of oil seeds. I know oilseed will be a little difficult to attain. We cannot attain self-sufficiency in that in the coming 2-3 years, but efforts are on. So therefore, by giving this example, I want to tell that there is a lot of changes which have happened. Since the farmer's distress issue was raised, I just want to touch upon two of the very important schemes of the government. Of course, I have dealt with micro-irrigation before, you have given the examples, but one is the unique product, insurance product, which this government has come out. That is the Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. Earlier also insurance schemes were there, but the premiums were high, and the, depending on the premium what you paid, the sum insured or the risk covered was also limited. So there was no incentive for a farmer to take advantage of these products. This new schemes caps the premium to either 2% or 1.5%, depending on whether you are growing the crop during Kharif or Rabi. And the excess of the premium amount is shared between the central government and the state government. In other words, with a very low premium, you get the sum insured to be the full cost of cultivation, which is a very unique product. Localized cost, like if your field is, let us say, harmed by hailstorm or even a disease, then also it gets covered. Perhaps if this Fasal Bima Yojana would have been there, been taken advantage of, then the banana plantation, which was affected by fungal attacks as mentioned, or the bunchy top, would have also been covered. So though our friend Dr. Subhachandran did not give lot of importance to Fasal Bima Yojana, but in some cases it is required. Not in all cases. Punjab refused to take the Fasal Bima Yojana, but because they feel that there are plenty of water, which is irrigated water, so they think it is not required. But yes, these are things which are required. Insurance is like health insurance. We don't insurance fully our life. To the extent it is necessary, we all insure our life. That does not mean I take a very 1 crore or a 2 crore policy. I may take it for 10 lakhs or 5 lakhs or something which I feel worth my life is. So insurance cover has to be, the individual has to decide what is the extent of insurance cover he needs to do himself. But it's a unique product, and since the government is paying part of the premium, it's a very attractive product. Most of the thing problem is that we need to create awareness of a massive scale. And as our friend said, there's a need for convergence of all the schemes. Unless there is convergence, many schemes are there. If it is attempted together, it is going to change the life. Touching upon one aspect which I thought I must let you know. How do you cover all the states in this country on a one uniform canvas? This government has, in the last 1 month, has hit upon a very novel idea. It has classified all these districts and have identified, and based on certain parameters, have identified 115 districts of this country to be extremely backward. And they are backward in almost all the things which you mentioned. If I take agriculture, it will be perhaps the least irrigated, the soil may be very degraded, the people below the poverty line must be there, the IMR rate, the MMR rate must be very high. So all these things are there, and after categorizing, we have identified 115 districts to be most backward, and our Honorable Prime Minister has coined the word their aspirational districts. We are targeting these 115 aspirational districts in such a way that if we can change these 115 districts, India is going to change, because this is where the backwardness lies, this is where the problem lies. And this is a very unique approach, because resources remaining the same, if we can change the attitude, if we can change the governance, if we can change the infrastructure, in these 115 districts, India will be a different place, and I am certain all segments of the economy is going to flourish. With these words, I thank, I just opened the subject, I didn't want to. Agriculture is a vast subject, though many people think they know agriculture well, but those who have spent donkey number of years in agriculture, they have always felt they have known very little of it. So therefore, with these words, parting words, I must thank Mr. Karthikeyan, for giving me this opportunity. I'm sorry that I am quite forthright in my expression. I might have hurt the feelings of many people, but well, that's it. Thank you very much, Jai Hind.